Oh, yes. Oh, the first person up tonight is Jason.
Hey, Jason.
And hi.
How's it going, bud boy?
Let me say hello. Let me say hello to all the people out there who are now watching us on the TV thing. Let me do this. Let me make that small. Okay. Just let me do a few things
here.
Well, hold on a second. Let me just. I gotta change things here so that they.
I don't see us. Huh?
Just my personal opinion. Your color scheme on the website before was better.
Thank you.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't mean to sound like a jerk. It just looks cheap now.
Really?
Yeah, it looks like a 12-year-old. The colors.
I kind of agree with you. I told you.
You know, just black and gray. You know, they're just a lot better, I think.
Well, I'm being your butt boy now. there we go.
We got that all done now.
Let me show you. There he is.
Here comes
Damien. He's calling. Hello, Damien.
Hello.
Yes. Now you said you like the way the new site looks.
You know, I like the color scheme. Actually, no. I'll take that back. I like the new layout.
Yeah.
I love the new layout. The color scheme, I have to agree with Jason, is probably not the best. But, you know, I really like it the way it is. I think it's better than
like
the website the way it was.
You have to talk into the microphone.
Well, you have it like all in your face.
Guess who the star of the show is? Let me see.
I like the layout, but I kind of agree, and I said something to you. The grays were nice. They were very...
I like the gray, but I also agree with the red, white, and blue scheme. You know, but I really want to say that I love the layout, where the feed thing is, the play pause button thing, and then tune in Snitcher live stream, Vimeo, YouTube. I mean, I think all that stuff is great. I really like the new layout.
I had something that was really cool. It was a button when you pushed it. The entire website moved over and revealed a side menu with a whole bunch of stuff.
Well, I think that there should be...
And when I did that, I found out that the audio didn't turn on automatically. So
you know,
I
think
that
there should be little hidden pages. When you click on the Ramble or you click on the Exchange or you click on the Intersection, it goes to its own little page.
You know something?
And,
it's
hidden.
Let me explain to you why I haven't
Easter
done
eggs.
Easter,
Easter
eggs.
Well, yeah. I might do Easter eggs. But
Easter eggs.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not an Easter egg. That's kind of like if we went to your thing, it would have a whole page about you.
Right, but it's like a reward. If you're interested in the arena, you click on this thing and you get a little reward for being interested.
Here's the reason I don't do that. I wanted to create a page, basically, that you could go to. And everything would be there without being cluttered. Okay?
And I totally agree with that.
I think I managed to pull it off.
Yeah, and you did. Absolutely.
You know? And as for the blue, I could change that to gray in 5 seconds if I wanted to.
Hey,
Phil, is the play button in the right spot yet?
It's in a much better
This
spot.
Is why I'm thinking of quitting.
Why?
You know, because of this. Because of this. Oh, here comes
Jeff's
coin.
It's too much. It's over, right?
What's wrong? You've got four people on.
That's not what I'm complaining about.
What are you complaining about?
Oh, now everybody's playing Monday morning quarterback on the website.
I got to ask a question.
Let's just get Bubbles on and tell us he's going to host the show from now on.
You know I love you, Damien. You know I love you. And I really appreciate your participation. And are you going to be back on next week?
Yeah, but you're full of shit, right?
No. But he writes me before I go on the air, and he complains about the new, you know, have these new,
I did not complain. I was only pointing out.
Little,
I was nitpicking. I did not complain.
Right? The new little tiles, which were really freeze frames of the animations that I've been running, you know, to plug the show.
And they look great.
Anyway, he says, it doesn't say FT, period. Now, wait a minute. Before you say it, anything, does anybody know? Hello, Jeff. How are you? Jeff? Are you there?
He's frozen.
No, he's not frozen. That's his picture, but we can't hear him.
How's that? Better?
There's Jeff. Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So the rest of these people. Okay.
Search mic's too loud.
Wait a minute.
Wait a minute.
There's some slap back coming from Jeff, I think. But no, that's okay now. Okay. Anyway, where was I? Oh, yeah. So. So he wants me to put on there the arena. And then I have the franchise MC. And then he wants me to put in FT period. Okay, now, hold on, Damien. Do any of you people know what FT period means?
Yeah, feet.
Feet, yes, that's good. Feet, definitely, in my book, inches, Y, yes. N period. Yeah. So feet.
That's half.
How about you, Jeff? Do you know what FT period means?
Tell us the real feet.
Huh?
What's the real FT?
Well, no, but what I'm saying is,
do you
know what it is?
No.
How about you, Jason? Now, you're younger. You should be hip to this.
FaceTime?
FaceTime. Okay, Damien. Oh, that's right. Have I made my point?
Okay, Jason, how old are you?
36.
36, okay. So do you consider yourself a millennial?
No, I'm Generation X.
Okay, so when you look at when you watch a video and it says Beyonce FT Jay-Z, what do you think that means?
Beyonce FaceTime Jay-Z? I don't know.
Yeah, no. And you know, okay, so I'm losing the head in the audience, but seriously, FT means featuring. The name of the show is supposed to be The Arena featuring the franchise MC.
No, but the featuring part is
really important. The FT dot is how you abbreviate featuring.
Well, you know, like I don't call this The Ramble starring Alex Bennett.
Of course you don't. No. This was the franchise MC's. The way he would like it phrased, because you know it's not only his stage name but his show. The arena featuring the franchise MC.
Jason? I don't get it. So am I too young to understand that, or too old to understand that?
Too old, apparently.
Uh-huh. Yes. And what's his?
Hold on a second. Are you a millennial, Damien?
No, I'm Gen X, definitely.
Okay, so what are you making a big deal about this for?
And I'm probably one of the youngest people that call into the show.
Surely you understand the stage name thing. So the arena featuring the franchise MC, and yeah, the franchise MC is his stage name, but you know, it's all about a big title.
Well, will you tell Mr. MC that this network probably has an incredibly old listening audience.
We know.
They look at it and it says the arena.
Feet.
Arena.
Foot.
No, not foot.
I just looked it up. Yeah. It says in pop music, guest appearances are often described with words featuring.
Thank you.
And it's abbreviated in lists. Either FEAT period or FT period.
Thank you.
And F slash or F period.
Well, I spent the last half hour
totally
before
not
I went
making
on the air
this shit up.
I put on the exchange, and then it took me a half hour, but it now says.
I know.
I
would just like to go on record and say that I truly appreciate the 30 minutes that you spent putting the FT dot on the existing logo for the arena.
This is two damn lazy kids that can't spell out featuring.
Have you seen the icon? There's no room for featuring. It's a big word, man.
Well, I mean, I took what was essentially the animations, which were rather large, and then first of all, they were all animations when I did my first run of the site, and that was so busy that I decided
how
to make them.
How busy was it?
It was so busy that I went back and made them all into graphics, and froze them and made them into graphics.
Do you mean GFs?
Yeah. But, you know, let me see here. Jeff's having real trouble staying online tonight.
I see him.
Yeah, I know. But then he said, it says, hold while we're trying to get the call back, you know, things like that. Oh man. Let me do something here.
I do sincerely appreciate you going in and adding the FT dot. I know that it was a very, very minor nitpicky thing, but I do appreciate it.
Oh, incredibly, wonderfully nitpicky.
I'm going to say goodnight.
Okay, good night.
I have a plane to catch.
Yeah, she has a plane to catch 2 days from now.
All right.
Okay.
Bye. Kiss, kiss, kiss.
Kiss, kiss. Jeff, are you there? Are you there? No, I guess Jeff isn't there. No. Huh. It's very strange what's happening with Jeff. He sometimes he gets on with no problem, and the other times he has a problem. If you're listening to me, Jeff, maybe just reboot your machine. That might
be... Jeff may be having connectivity problems or bandwidth problems.
Yeah, that could be. That could be. So anyway, have we solved the problem?
I think so.
Well, now the other one that drove me nuts was Living Sexy, which all of a sudden today decides to change its name to Connections.
Well, you know, I will have to agree with Marjorie and say you didn't have to change that shit today. Yeah, I mean, seriously, you could have given them, you could have said, okay, great, I'll deal with it in a moment, and given them 2 weeks. And after 2 weeks, if you had changed it, they would have been great.
Oh, and that the other thing I have to change the promo, but that's Rob just making a one sentence change he has to send me, you know.
And coming up at midnight, catch Living Sexy.
No, he has to go. No, he's good at this, and I'll just drop it right into where the other one was.
Connections. You just have to say connections long enough to fill in the whole Living Sexy part.
But you don't have to even fill it in. I just move everything over. Don't worry, I got this whole thing down.
You should do it with somebody else's voice. Damien should say connections, so it's like totally off. It was totally edited.
You should get girlfriend to say it. Get a girl to say it.
Yes, and be sure to stay tuned at midnight for Connections. There's 1 o'clock. Connections. No, it's a matter of him just doing the sentence over again.
Is it a dating show now?
I have no idea, to tell you why.
Nobody here listens to it.
I listen to it. I mean, I'm not in rapt attention. I don't listen to anything. I don't listen to you, for Christ's sake. You know?
I know.
He doesn't listen to his callers.
You know what? I consider listening to Alex my homework, but, you know, and if I have time, I will listen to The Intersection and other shows. But seriously, I don't have a whole lot of time to listen to you guys' shows. So,
yeah.
But if I'm gonna... It's going to be Alex's show, I probably always listen to Alex's show.
Usually I hear your show, but I'm sitting on the toilet, or I'm...
For a half hour.
...taking a whiz, yeah, and it's in the other room, and then I come in here, and I have to set some things up, and I do listen to your show, but...
I gotta say,
I think,
you know...
I phased out after about the 25th day of Star Trek.
Well, I suppose that you should be really glad that coming October 1st, we're going to celebrate the coming of 2017 with 90 days of Babylon 5.
No, you better not.
I'm just kidding.
I never liked Babylon 5, even though I know the guys who did it.
You love Babylon 5. All of your listeners love Babylon 5. It's the greatest show ever made. Everybody knows it.
No. Space 1999.
Love that show.
Dude, when you brought that up the other night, I laughed my ass off.
That was
off.
The same guy who did Thunderbirds Go.
Yeah, Thunderbirds Go.
The puppet thing with...
And nobody knew what you were talking about. I'm like, Thunderbirds, how come nobody knows this?
They love that show in England. That's how stupid the English are. You know, we think of them as having great erudition, and they'll watch a bunch of puppets flying in airplanes.
It's not about them being stupid. It's about them having nothing else to watch.
But Anderson was the guy's name. I'm trying to remember the first name. Something Anderson. Anyway, he decided to do something with real human beings, and he did Space 1999, and it was not
terrible.
Terrible show.
So terrible, and I really, you know, I loved it when I was a little kid because I loved anything that had to do with space. But when I watch it as an adult, I'm like, oh my God, I cannot believe that I even followed this as a little child. I can't follow it as an adult. It is such a terrible show. Yeah. It's so bad.
On Babylon 5, I knew the guy who did the special effects because mm-hmm. the special effects were being done with a program that the company I work for, NewTek, and I didn't work for NewTek, but was associated
with the video toaster.
They had a thing called Lightwave, which was a
yes, which I still use.
You still use it?
Yes. If anybody would like to go to my Facebook page, they can see all of the stuff that I've created in Lightwave. It is so awesome, and Alex, I would have to say that I actually uncovered in your storage unit an actual video toaster. And I am blown the fuck away by looking at this piece of hardware. It says video toaster on it. I'm like,
well, it's got to be an Amiga with a video toaster inside.
Yeah, well, I mean, this is, you have the hardware in your storage unit. And I'm looking at this going, I don't even know what to do with this. This is such an, this is a phenomenon right here.
Take it home and plug it in and see if it works.
Yeah, I know, but I mean, for those of you who don't know, the video toaster was like an entire PC on its own, and it plugged into the Amiga, which is a PC on its own, and then you had to have a monitor plugged into the Amiga. So we're talking about a lot of actual physical space that this video toaster, which was a very revolutionary device when it came out, you know, it still takes a huge amount of space.
Well, I also had a program.
I don't have that amount of space in my apartment.
I had a third party piece of equipment, software, that allowed me to use the video toaster to actually edit videotape. In other words, I would make all the ads and then I would just push a button and all the machines would start going and queuing up to the various spots they had to get to, because I had time codes in there. But yeah, I mean, it was amazing.
That may be in your storage unit too, and I wouldn't have recognized it. But when I see something that says video toaster, I, you know, just like the 3D, your 3DO. When I uncovered your 3DO, I was like, oh my God.
Hey, throw that shit out, will you? If you want it, take it. The 3DO, I mean, come on.
I have your 3DO. It has a busted CD drive, so I have to repair it. But I would really like to play Star Control 2 again.
I imagine if I go over to your place, I walk in, the whole place looks like my storage unit.
Yeah. You know, I've been asking you.
Yeah.
I've been meaning to ask you, what should I do with this?
Oh, I know what that is.
You know exactly what this is.
That's something that you just absolutely probably just jizzed all over.
I know, but
that is a Halliburton case, which are very good cases. You know them, Phil, right?
I
don't know if this will show up on TV. Let me blow up your frame.
I have a briefcase. Okay.
Show them what it says.
It's aluminum, so it's nice aluminum. And light.
Yeah, on the inside. No, you have a Halliburton case, but not like this one. This one is maybe worth much more than the actual Halliburton case. And it has a thing. Read that, because we can't see it that well.
Okay. I'm going to read it, and then I'll hold it up to the camera. It says, Alex, here's your very own Star Trek flight kit. Encounter at Farpoint premieres tonight at 8 on TV 44. It repeats Saturday at 6, just before the second edition of the Alex Bennett Comedy Hour. Saturday at 8 and 11, and Sunday at 6.
Well, you see, I saw
Suzanne,
that.
Suzanne, and let me hold it up to the camera here so that...
Okay.
This is video night. Okay, there we go.
There it is. There it is. And what happened was this woman, Suzanne, who signed it, I went into her office, and this was a promotional gift sent by UPN to their stations. Yes. And I coveted it. I said, how do I get one? Can you get a hold of them and get me one? Now show the payoff on this whole Halliburton.
This is a very coveted thing. Now I already sent you the key ring.
Yes.
That's what I sent you the key your new storage unit keys on. But here's a little comm badge.
Yeah.
Came in here. It's a little pin-on comm badge here.
Yeah.
And then. Here's the keys to the case here.
Yep.
Because that's that. And then I've got, there's a little...
For all the people watching this on live stream, you can see what we're talking about.
How many GabNet dollars does that cost?
And then there's a little digital quartz. It looks like a clock.
Uh-huh.
It's probably got an alarm and stuff like that.
Does it say Star Trek on it? I think it does.
It does say Star Trek The Next Generation right on the bottom here.
This was all for the premiere of Star Trek Next Generation.
This is Star Trek The Next Generation Encounter at Farpoint. I mean, this briefcase, I've been reluctant to even tell you about it. because I just want to caress it, you know, for the rest of my life.
The best part about it.
That's all that's in here at the moment.
No, not in it. On it.
On it?
On it, close it, and show the front of it. What does it say?
It's printed on the top here. You can only see it if it's embossed.
Slightly you can see it.
Yeah, it says Star Trek The Next Generation in the logo.
Yeah.
And then at the bottom it says Paramount 75th anniversary right here on the bottom here.
So that is officially a Star Trek Halliburton case.
Yeah. It also has this tag on the front here. It says flight kit, crew member, USS Enterprise, ship, planet Earth, origin space, or destination space, origin planet Earth, ship, USS Enterprise. They kind of misprinted it on the tag here.
You should see if you can get on Pawn Stars and see what they'd give you, and then be like, nah.
How much did you pay? Well,
here's the thing. Well, here's
Phil
the
just
thing.
Left. Otherwise, you know, I was going to ask him how much he paid for his Halliburton case.
Here's the thing. You know, an aluminum briefcase that's embossed with Star Trek The Next Generation, 75th anniversary, and it's got an actual note inside to whoever saying this is your case because the premiere of Encounter at Farpoint is tonight.
Yeah.
You know, that by itself is worth, I don't even know.
About 50 cents.
But if you are an Alex Bennett fan, if you are an Alex Bennett fan and you are listening to Alex Bennett on Live 105 in 1988 when Encounter at Farpoint aired, this briefcase is priceless, and that's why I've been drooling over it all this time. And if anybody's interested, seriously, give us an offer.
He's been coveting my stuff and jizzing all over it. I just know.
Only this. I saw this, and I was like, oh, my God. I don't even know what to do with this.
To try to go on Pawn Stars, you know, that might be something they'd be interested in, and it might get you some publicity.
Well, only if you know who Alex Bennett is.
And not to say anything negative about Alex Bennett. It doesn't have anything to do with that. It has to do with Star Trek being on there.
Oh, it's true.
Trek is a little bit bigger of a name.
You know, I mean, okay, so I would be willing to pay, say, $100 for that briefcase all by itself. But if you told me this briefcase was previously owned by Alex Bennett, I'm sorry.
The price would be 50 bucks.
No, I would have to say I would double my price. I would double my offer for this.
And then if we added the Damien jizzed all over it. Phil, riddle me this, Batman. How much did your case cost you?
It was probably around between $300 and $400. I have one just like that. I have the actual briefcase, and that other one's a camera case like yours, but it's a little larger. Yes. I think it's around $300 or $400.
Oh, really? Okay. Yeah. So this thing probably could be worth upwards to $1,000 to a collector.
Honest collector, and to you know, really, we want to sell it to an Alex Bennett fan. We really, honestly, want to sell it to an Alex Bennett.
Hey, are you an Alex Bennett fan, Damien?
Not at all. I hate that guy.
Well, once you work with me, that's it. You know, yeah, whatever, I know. Whatever idolization you had of me has disappeared and gone south. Yeah.
No, and just so you know, I am actually going to go to your storage unit here very shortly, probably on Monday, and get you some more tapes so I can send them to you. And I'm sorry I've been slacking off for the last month or so.
That's okay. I can't dub them off fast enough. I mean, some of them I'm not dubbing off.
Some of them are not interesting.
And sometimes I get one of these tapes, and it says, I wrote something on it, like, you know, the president of Bolivia or whatever, and I go, oh, I still have that interview with the president of Bolivia, huh? And I play it, and the tape is blank.
I put in tapes into your box that you wrote interesting and an arrow, and I don't even know what that is, but I threw it in there anyway, and I'm guessing that the arrow shows where on the tape the interesting stuff is. But I don't have a tape player. I can't listen to it.
I
sent it to you hoping that you thought it was interesting still.
They give me the tape as I would walk out the door, right? I would just put it in my pocket and then throw it, you know, over in a corner somewhere. You know, and so I never made sure that what I thought was on those tapes were really on those tapes. The best stuff I had was when I was doing those... the DAT tapes. Though the quality on those things are just...
So you haven't found any of your tapes degrading, like getting brittle and falling apart?
You know something? These tapes are in better shape than I thought they would be.
It's because they've never been played. They've been recorded, and nobody's ever played them to review them. Or if they have, they've also played them once.
Also, I am in a humidity-controlled storage
unit. It's not.
Really?
No, if they told you that, they were lying. Now, it happens to be on the third floor in the interior of a building, so you're not going to get any humidity or anything like that. So it is actually very well maintained, but it is definitely not climate controlled.
Alex?
Yeah.
The 4-inch Slimline Zero Halliburton is $385 on Amazon.
Yeah, yeah. So that isn't... I don't think that's a slim line.
Okay, the non-slim line is $625. The four-inch.
Look at that. Yes.
Can you add Star Trek to the name and see if you know?
This says I should mention that on the brand name says Zero Centurion Elite.
So it's not.
It's not a Halliburton. It's a Halliburton ripoff. That's for damn sure.
And it has a WZ-1 keyway.
It's funny that in the entire time you were doing those 30 fucking days of Star Trek, you not once mentioned that case.
I didn't want to mention it because it's yours. You know, I mean, what am I supposed to say about it? Hey, Alex, look what I got. Nah, 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 nah. You know what I mean? I didn't want to mention it until I asked you what I should do with it.
The 3DO is yours, complimentary. Okay?
Well, thank you. Do you want the briefcase?
Well, I probably don't want to get rid of it, but I don't know if I need to have it here.
I'll hold on
okay.
to it.
So exactly. Want, so be, I mean, are we way, are we going to rent a new going to rent a new storage unit for you to put this in?
No, if you want to be the guardian,
the custodian
of my case, because I don't know that someday I might be dead broke and need to auction that fucking thing off.
Zero Halliburton makes the Centurion Elite case.
Okay.
There's a used one for $200.
Wow.
On looks like Amazon.
Well, this has more to it.
I am hereby officially taking custodial possession of your briefcase here.
Yeah.
And if you ever decide to sell it, I mean, it's got the certificate inside, the actual personalized note to Alex Bennett. So seriously, it may be worth $200, but it's worth $400 to an Alex Bennett fan.
Well, I think that probably because, you see, I mean, the one thing that makes it distinctive is the Star Trek logo is embossed onto the case.
Well, it's not embossed, it's printed.
Is it printed? It looked to me it always kind of been etched.
It's printed on it in silver.
But no, but if it were printed, it probably would have worn off by now. And the fact is,
no, because you've had it in a box for years and years and years. Put you can
it,
see
put
here.
Put it right up to the camera. Yeah, people can then see the Star Trek. Yeah, put it right up to the camera. See?
Oh, cool. You can see it's not actually embossed. It's just printed.
Well, in any event, I think that makes it special.
It makes it incredibly special, especially this part right here at the bottom,
Paramount,
where it says Paramount's 75th anniversary.
Yeah, wait a minute. Let me bring this up here so they can see it. There we go. Wait a minute. It's a little blurry.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
go getting back. The camera to try to focus on it. There we go.
Yeah.
Paramount's 75th anniversary.
Yeah.
But and then oh, let's see here. I'm trying to. There we go. Okay. Star Trek Next Generation logo.
Yep. But so anyway, that probably made Damien very happy. Well, thank you, Damien, for that.
Yeah, no, it makes me very happy, but it's one of those things that I don't know what to do with because it's yours. I'm happy to keep custody of it.
If you had it, if you owned it, what would you do with it? Sell it?
Nothing. No. I'm a collector. I would absolutely keep this, not only as a Star Trek collectible, like the fucking Star Trek collectible, Star Trek, you know, the Next Generation premiere, the Encounter at Farpoint, and this is like the Star Trek collectible, but moreover, this is personalized to you.
Yeah.
The guy that I've followed since I was in high school.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously.
Yeah, he stalked
this me. This briefcase is so personal to me that I don't think I would ever give it up.
Here's the deal.
And
here's the
when
deal.
I
you
die,
have custodian.
Everybody else is going to sell it because it doesn't mean anything
calm down,
to them.
Damien. Calm down, Damien. you have custodianship of it. And so, you know, hi, Patrick. Can I tell you, though? Something this will make you this is jizz worthy. I got another gift one time, and somebody said I used to work for Paramount, and when I left Paramount, I took a few things with me, and I want you to have this. And what it was, and it was made out of fiberglass, but kind of soft fiberglass. And I said, "What is that?" And he says, "That's a Klingon drinking cup."
Kapla.
And I said, why does it have a little hole in the top? They said, that's where they put the fishing line. I said, for what? So it could float around. Do you remember the movie where a whole bunch of Klingons get killed?
Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country.
The Undiscovered Country. I can actually, in that film, show you the cup floating.
Based on your descriptions over the last 20 years, I can also identify which cup you're talking about because, you know, you've told me it was seen in a number of shots.
No, seen in only one shot.
Okay. Yeah, you're right.
All the air has been removed, and the Klingons are dead, and everything in the room is floating around, including these Klingon drinking cups. And there were several of them, but I saw mine go by because mine had a certain characteristic on it.
Right, and when they turn on the gravity, a bunch of the cups fall to the ground and shatter. Mm-hmm. So I can only assume that your cup is
not one of the ones that shatter. No. But anyway, let me tell you what happened. So I work for Plate Incorporated, right? And my friend Paul started what he called his science fiction museum, and he had things like the hoverboard from uh, from Back to the Future and a whole bunch of things. And I said, I want to give you something to put in there. I said, it's still mine, but it's part of the display. And I gave him the Klingon cup. And he was, you know, that was jizz worthy. And then the company went out of business, and we never went back up there, and they sold everything that was in the place, including my goddamn Klingon cup.
All right, so a word out to all of our listeners out there. If you can get your hands on this Klingon cup, please return it to Alex Bennett.
And it's not,
it is his rightful possession.
And we're not referring to a thing that's Klingon put over his penis.
Yeah, no. It is not a Klingon athletic device.
It's not an athletic supporter for Klingons. Anyway, thank you for that show and tell tonight, Damien. That was very
nice.
I'm sorry, everyone.
Yeah. So you've been working somewhere else, and that's why you couldn't do your show all week, right?
Yeah, they had me fill in at one of our other sites, which is in the neighboring town, which, you know, they close at 6, which means I don't get here until 6:30, which is when my show starts. And yeah, I'm just not able to. I need a good 5 minutes at least.
Oh, they have better internet over there.
No. Oh, you know, sometimes I it takes me about 30 seconds when I start hearing a theme going, I start revving everything up.
Yeah. Yeah, no, sometimes it takes me 30
and
seconds.
I make sure I get the rest of the turd out of my ass and I get in here.
There are definitely times when I step in here at 6:29 and hit the theme song and
let's change the subject so this doesn't turn into the 32 days of Star Trek. Yeah. But he's going to be putting together a show which we're not going to run on the network. I don't know how we're going to run it exactly. I will make sure it gets onto iTunes.
Okay.
Or I may even teach you how to put it onto iTunes.
That would be okay.
You know, and then we would somehow run it in our on-demand using that XML file. But I'll explain it to you later. Anyway, hello, Patrick. Hello, Phil. Hello, Jason. Hello, Scott. And how was your dinner last night, Phil?
Oh, it was very nice. My friend Will cooked up a storm. I brought over a bottle of wine that was supposed to be the best thing since sliced bread, and it sucked. we watched the Jets beat the Bills, and then I came home.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, we had two people on last night.
Yeah, I heard.
It was one of the best shows we've ever done.
Yeah, I was listening to the last 15 minutes or so as
we
I was driving home.
We had Tom Yamaguchi taking a dog out for a dump.
Yeah.
That was great.
Which was, I think, one of the better moments we've had on the show.
Absolutely.
But look at it tonight. It's slow tonight, too. Although
the only thing that would be better is you taking a dump.
So. You know, the only thing that would be better than that would be 30 days of Tom Yamaguchi taking his dog out for a dump.
Yeah, I might do that.
Seriously, you should.
Yeah. I want to find out from Patrick something. Patrick?
Yeah?
What are the problems you're having tonight?
I don't know. The first time I tried coming on, there was no video thing, and then it just quit. And now this time everybody just froze on me and waited a few minutes just to see if it would come back, and then
I have a theory about Skype. First of all, the first theory is it sucks. But now the other theory is that everywhere you are in the country is using a different node or something of Skype. You know what I'm saying? And so that you could suddenly have problems with the freezing and, you know, kicking you off and everything, where Jason's doing just fine where he is and I'm doing great where I am. You know, it could also be something like bandwidth in your neighborhood suddenly going slowing down, you know. So who knows? Who knows?
I think you're going to see a lot of this starting to change in the next few years. So all the telecom companies and cable providers are all going to be switching over to fiber optics.
Is fiber optic better?
Immensely.
Okay, now Jason, you're a person who works in that area, right?
Yeah.
So you can tell me why.
You know. The amount of data you can put over a little tiny piece of glass is just immensely better than what you can put over a coax or a copper. You know, we can push a gig easy over fiber.
Yeah. Where, you know, right now we're limited about 100 megs, you know, yeah, per second. But, you know, and that's what we're starting to put out right now is fiber. And, you know, that's something you might even look into too, Damien, to see if you guys can get fiber put in there. Because, hold on, because AT&T is very willing to be putting it into especially commercial locations, because you got probably have a commercial building next door who we put it into one, you know, it's already there, and then we put it into the next one, and it's even cheaper. Okay.
But here's the thing. You got fiber, and it comes up to, I imagine, when they put in some outlets in my back hallway, or not hallway, but stairwell, that eventually, whenever they decide to put Fios in here, is what's going to be used to then run it into my apartment, if I choose to take it or not take it. In the meantime, while they were digging those holes, they also screwed up the intercom system, but that's another story altogether. So it's going to be fiber, probably up to that box, right?
I don't know how they're doing it. I'm going to be starting a fiber project for an apartment complex pretty soon, and we're actually bringing fiber right into the unit itself.
Really? Because yeah. I heard that what happens is it's only fiber sometimes up to the building, and then it's cable for the rest of it.
That's not going to make that much of a difference. That's still good. Because what they're going to be putting in after that fiber is going to be brand new. So it's going to be great.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't even get that option. They're going to run fiber to the box, and then I personally have to dig a trench to my house if I would like to have any sort of access beyond DSL.
Well, I hope the war or something breaks out, because then that trench will be useful.
We can hang fiber in the air, too, so.
For Lilliputians.
Yeah. But
I'm going to upgrade the semaphore.
Up the semaphore, yeah. Well, I mean, I'm thinking of going to
flag the flag.
I'm thinking of definitely going to Fios with the.
And then a lot of times it's asynchronous too, so you can get just about what you're putting.
Well, no,
up
the
and download speeds.
My download speed will be cut in half. I'm 300 now. It'll be 150, but it'll be. Yeah. But I'm 20 going up, but now I'll be 150 going up. So. You know, I don't use a full 300 anyway.
You can't, because nobody else is out there pushing 300 back to you.
You know.
Yeah, exactly. No server is actually serving you with 300.
I mean, even if you go to some site where you download stuff, they're not pushing it to you at 300.
No.
You know. So.
Yeah, and that's what I wish that, you know, the company I worked for would do. A lot of our central offices, they're just almost half-empty buildings now. And it's like, why don't you turn all these buildings into servers? You know, and just have, you know, stacks and stacks of servers in there, and then bring the server closer to the customer, you know, the end user.
Yeah.
But the way that telecom's regulated now, as soon as we were to put a server into one of our buildings, we have to open it up and let everybody use it.
Oh, okay. Wow. Because I just think that I've got to take this Fios, because what I'm thinking of doing is doing what Phil's done, a lot of other people have done, and cut the cord. Because there's so many options now. Sony has a thing called PlayStation View. It doesn't work necessarily on the PlayStation. It just works on Roku. I think they also have it for the Apple TV.
And it definitely works on the PlayStation.
Definitely works on the PlayStation. But it has over 100 cable channels for like $52 a month. So that's one way to cut the cord, okay?
And that's what everybody's going to be doing pretty soon. It's going to be just like Netflix. You're going to pay per stream. Just like right now, you know, you might rent a cable box.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to rent a cable box anymore. You know, all the TVs are going to be smart TVs.
The FCC is trying to pass a law saying now that the cable companies have to allow their users to use Rokus or Apple TVs.
And they want it, too, because that's less of a crap that the providers have to invest
in,
because
hardware they have to deal with, and they're still making money off the internet.
And that's what we're trying to get away from, being a hardware based operation to being software
based. Well, here's the thing that I'm waiting for is Hulu is going to be coming out with a service for $49 a month, I think it's going to be, and you will get all those cable channels. Plus, you will get, because they carry ABC and they carry NBC, the local ABC and NBC stations. And if you want to record something, you'll record it to the cloud and play it back. And that's just using your Roku or your Apple TV or whatever. So it's going to be interesting to see what this Hulu initiative is. It may be even better than what Sony is doing. And certainly far better than what, what's that company, Sling, is doing. They only have about 20 channels, 25 channels.
Not even. Sling is right. Sling is doing a good job, but, you know, we're really in the very beginning of this whole thing. You know, Sling is a step in the right direction. PlayStation View is actually a better step in the right direction. And what Jason is talking about is actually going to be what he said, you know, ultimately what we're all going to be doing.
Yeah. But I like buying Hulu now without commercials.
Which is Me too, man. It's so awesome.
Yeah, you're doing that too. And CBS is now offering that with their thing for $9.
I heard that.
But the only reason I'm not going to get it... Oh, by the way, Star Trek isn't starting till May.
I know. Grr.
Yeah, but anyway...
Big disadvantage to not having the exchange this week is I didn't get to announce that or talk about it.
Yeah, but anyway, the thing is that the CBS thing, I thought, well, may I get it because I can then get all those shows without commercials. And I said, what the fuck is there on CBS I want to watch?
Yeah, nothing.
Face the Nation.
Face the Nation, yeah.
Sunday mornings.
Yeah. CBS Sunday mornings, yeah. But I bet they don't even have that on there.
They're counting on Big Bang Theory and they're counting on Star Trek.
Yeah, I have it, and I watch Face the Nation on Sunday mornings.
Yeah.
The new guy isn't as good as Tim Russert, but, you know.
But is it day and date? Is it hour for hour that it's
Yeah, it's live.
Oh, they have a live feed of their local station.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, but you can't freeze it, and you can't record it.
I don't know. I never tried.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't, but that's what Hulu's going to offer, is the ability to record shows. Although,
but I don't understand how, because those are all just streams. A stream is usually... archived already.
No, it's not stream. It's live TV.
But what you might want to record.
They also have streams.
Well, you see, I mean, they have archives of all those shows, but they usually are the next day. You know, and if you want to see carry the, you know, watch the show on, say, Channel 2 here in New York, which they carry on CBS, and then you want to record it, where are you going to record it? You can't off of Roku, but you could, if somehow Hulu had a situation where you could put it up on the cloud, and then you
There are recorders that are made to record off of...
Yeah, but Hulu will have this built into the system.
I understand.
And that's why it was even a few years ago that somebody was talking about, you know, they had the technology that came out. They're saying all these companies need to get rid of their DVRs because it's cheaper and easier to basically record it in the cloud. Everything would be archived, and then you just go back and watch their own archive. You know, you think you're recording it, but all you're saying is, I have access to this archive.
Well, could I tell you, though, that I honestly believe that after everybody cuts the cord and they have all these services allowing you to cut the cord, you're going to look at your bill every month and it's going to be larger than the old one. Yeah, you know, because they'll find ways of making money. They'll raise the rates on the internet carriage, stuff like that, you know.
It's true. You know, my bill is right now it's less, but I'm really not suffering for anything. I have Showtime, which I had before. And, you know, with the only thing I'm missing is NBC and, you know, Live and Fox News. And other than that, I would not. There's no difference.
You can get Fox News. There's Roku has a Fox News. You can get
live
Fox
feed.
News. I don't know if it's live. There might be a live feed there. I can't remember. You know what's really great? I mean, I'm not a sports fan, but girlfriend, I downloaded, put up ESPN for her, and they do have live feeds of ESPN on there.
Well, so does Sling. Sling has two ESPN channels.
Yeah, well, this thing had not only the two ESPN channels, but they had channels for every one of the courts.
The guy that I was at his house last night watching the game gets 40 channels on a digital TV antenna, rabbit ears, But across the street from him was is a guy, a friend of mine and his, who was there last night, and he says he doesn't get any channels on his digital antenna. Yeah. So, you know, it works, but yeah, I guess it just depends on where you are.
Let me just say, and then I'll go to Jason because he's got his hand up. I forgot what I was going to say. Go ahead, Jason.
This is going back to your guys' old thing about saying that these cell phone companies want to get rid of the unlimited data. Mm-hmm. At least the company that I work for, is, as long as I'm understanding it correctly, they should be announcing it pretty soon. But they also have a TV service that they're going to soon allow you to stream your TV service, and that's not going to count against your data. Yeah. So you can be at the train station watching TV, and you know that uses the most data, anything is video.
Yeah.
So they'll sit there and they'll let you watch their TV service without using any of your data.
Well, the problem, I watch Sling on my phone, and I have unlimited data, so...
But if you didn't have unlimited data, you'd be counting against your data.
You don't have unlimited data, Phil.
I don't have unlimited data.
I'm telling you right now, you don't have it. Once you get up to five...
It's still unlimited, they'll just slow you down, in which they probably don't even slow you down anymore.
Well, yes, they do. They do.
They do throw you down, but, you know, I have a 15-gigabyte plan through AT&T plus rollover data. I never hit that 15 gigabytes, I'm always using rollover data from the last month.
One of the reasons why our show failed to be a TV show when we were doing it in the very beginning, and thank you, Patrick, for calling that show and being part of it, was because if people were watching it on their cell phone or they were watching it on their iPad and they were somewhere where they were using the data up, you only had to watch two of those shows to use all your data up for the week, for the month. You know, a tremendous amount of data whenever you're streaming video. And
Well, like I said, that's what's cool about what the service that they're going to be, the company I work for is going to be offering. You know, if you can watch any of their TV and you're not using your data.
Yeah, but like I only have a 10. Do you think any of these companies are going to offer us something that isn't going to make them as much money as they used to make out of you? I mean, eventually they're going to make sure they're still making the same amount.
Well, some of them just have to because other companies are offering it, so they have to be like, all right, well, they're offering this. We have to offer something to keep up with them or else they're going to leave.
Yeah.
So it's that, still that free market, you know, capitalism where you got to compete.
What do you use for TV watching? You just have a cable box and that's it?
Cable box, yep.
Yeah.
I'm not interested in paying what's going to add up to the same amount of money as my cable for already different things until something gets straightened out and somebody has everything.
Well, I'll tell you something. Right now, I did the math on this. Right now, I'm paying $339 a month. Now, nobody go over...
No fucking way.
Well, no, wait a minute. Let me explain. No fucking way. I've got a thing called the Signature Service, and I've got... five boxes in this house, okay? Because I've got
a pen right here.
Wait a minute.
And have Signature Service.
Yeah, and but I sat down and started adding. If I started paying for all of these things that I'm going to need every month, it would come to about $175 a month. You know, so I would save a lot of money.
Does that include your internet connection?
Yeah. That would include the Fios at 150 megabytes, and then it would be the, whatever service I decide to take, whether it's Hulu or PlayStation View for the various services. And my girlfriend wants the local CBS, NBC station, so, you know.
Damien warned me when I asked him about cutting the cord, because I knew that he was not using a service, and so he said to me, "You may not like the interface between it because you can't channel surf." I used to sit there with the remote control, my finger on the button, going station.
Yeah,
I can't do that anymore. But you know, after a couple of weeks, I found that I enjoyed what I was doing much better not doing that.
Yeah, you actually enjoy watching a show instead of flipping between shows.
Yeah, exactly. But Damien did give me a good piece of advice, and he was correct. And so if you are a channel surfer, it may not be what you're looking for, but I...
You'll get over it. Channel surfing is such a 20th century thing.
Right. Well, I got over it. And to tell you the truth, I enjoy what I'm doing more than when I was surfing the channels. It used to drive everybody in the house crazy, too, because...
Well, you see, I could live without the local stations. Girlfriend can't. She likes her 6:30 news on Channel 4.
Me
and,
too.
You know,
I liked the KTVU in the Bay Area, which was Channel 2. Yeah. I think that was
but
a Fox.
You can use an off.
Yeah, I do miss KTVU morning news.
Yes. Yeah.
But see now, like my morning news is, I like my local Fox News, but I can stream them online.
I want to watch in the morning, and I want today's news now.
But that's what I'm saying. I can go to my, foxdetroit.com or whatever, and I can watch live.
No, the reality is that we all want to get up out of our bed and groggily walk to the TV and hit the power button and just have the news come on.
It's
we
a
don't
smart
want
TV,
to navigate to a website.
So how do you stream? You have a computer dedicated there that you can then stream to your TV?
No, if you have a smart TV, you could just do it over your TV. Me, I'm saying I don't, mine's just I could, if I really wanted to, I could put it on my computer and then just have my computer plugged into my TV.
His is a dumb TV, or as Hillary would call it, deplorable.
Mine's a Trump TV.
I don't know if my TV does that or not.
Is your TV a smart TV?
It's smarter than me.
So you don't know, but you have a Apple laptop or whatever, right?
It does not have Roku built in, right?
But I'm saying you could take your Apple computer and plug it into your TV, into the HDMI. They have an adapter plug, and then you could just be playing it on your laptop and have it plugged into your computer or onto your TV, and it's playing on your TV.
Patrick, do you have a smart TV?
Yeah.
What is your? It must be an older TV then.
Yeah, it's just a 44, 46 flat screen.
It's what your parents used to call a TV.
Do you know how you can take any old TV and make it into a smart TV, and you can do it for under $100?
A Roku?
No. Go buy a very simple. Just go buy a. Any VCR today? Any DVD player? Excuse me, VCR. What am I saying? any DVD player, and they've got all those smart functions built right into them.
I've got your DVD player.
Huh?
I have a new DVD player. So.
Well, maybe it has. If you go into it, it probably can get you. You can get Netflix if you want it. You can get Hulu on it. You can get a lot of those things on it.
Yeah, I have a 3-year-old Blu-ray player, and it has all that access.
Yeah, so all the stuff that a smart TV would do, although I got an LG, and I really love how that thing works.
I'll look and see what mine is. I don't remember.
We don't care. He took his earphones off.
He's probably not going
to
be.
Phil there. Always has
it's,
to go.
It's TV night, not unless you can bring it to the camera. Do we care?
I got to tell you, the other night he was. Oh, here comes Jeff. Now let's see if Jeff can get on now. Are you there, Jeff?
I can come on now.
Yeah, you are on now.
Crash.
There you go, Jeff. Let's see if we get a stable signal and if we can get some video off of you. That would be nice too. Anyway, what was I going to say?
You were saying something with Phil the other night?
Oh, yeah. Phil always has to show you what he bought. And he gives you the name and whatever. The other night we were talking about Cuisinarts, and he told me about the SS.
Oh, yeah, you were going
to
buy that.
The SS. Yeah. Well, I didn't need to because my machine, I figured out why it was leaking, and I fixed it. But eventually I will go get a Cuisinart because it looks to be very good. Phil paid, how much you pay, Phil, for yours?
$199, and then I got 20% back.
So you paid how much?
$160.
Yours is an SS 700, is it?
Yeah.
Supposedly they were having trouble with those.
haven't had a bit of trouble.
You haven't had a problem, but they were having trouble, so they came out with a newer model called the 780, which is exactly like the 700 in functionality and everything else, and it's only 167.
Oh, well, that's the same price. I paid 160.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is you paid it because you had a discount. This is without the discount. It's 167.
Well, it's the same with any technology. You wait 6 months, and it's going to come down $50.
Yeah,
I'm very happy with this Cuisinart.
Well, I'm dying for mine to break because this thing, you can actually tell it when you want a cup of coffee. Mine just turns the machine on. You got to still make the coffee yourself, and I want to be the ultimate lazy old fuck.
Oh, this one makes different size things.
So does mine.
Oh. With the push of a button, it's
mine
very
will
easy.
Do a whole carafe. I don't think yours will do a carafe, will it?
I don't know. Yeah. I don't drink the carafe. Even when I had the carafe,
well,
I never
I have
used.
No reason for a carafe because nobody else is drinking coffee with me. I don't have any friends.
Yeah. You know. He drinks by himself.
Yeah, it's really
but you
sad.
Do have
every, it's really sad every morning when I drink my coffee alone. You know, I could go up to Starbucks, but then I'd have to deal with those fucking baristas.
You should know that, man, so I yell at them.
People trying to write your name on a cup.
Do you have a Starbucks name?
Oh, yeah, they do that. You're right.
Yeah.
That's funny, too. Tony,
wait a minute. They gotta write your name. Do you have a Starbucks name?
No, but what's your name?
Elvis.
Huh?
Elvis.
Elvis? I had somebody who... what was it? I can't remember.
What's the comedian that was on the other day? Will Durst?
Yeah.
His was Waldo.
Where's Waldo?
Where's
Waldo? I was trying to think of.
Mine's Eric. I don't even know where I got that, but I always tell him Eric. I don't want them to know my real name.
Elvis always gives them a smile. Yeah.
Elvis always gives them a smile.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was trying to.
That's true.
Yeah. I just don't go to Starbucks because I can't get with the nomenclature.
Oh, I've refused to participate. I just small, medium, large.
I went in once and asked for a large coffee, and they looked at me like I was a Martian.
Well, they tried that with me. And so they said, well, a large is a venti. I said, okay, then give me a 20. It's 20. Venti is 20 in Italian, so I'll take a 20.
Yeah, no, I don't understand how they expect people to do this. I mean, the only time I ever go to Starbucks is when I'm out of coffee in the house, and I have to drive at 6 in the morning to go get some coffee. Otherwise, I will die. And, you know, I don't understand how these people expect me to say Viente and Grande and these sort of things at 6:10 in the morning. I mean, it's just...
Well, speaking of names and shifting gears here, last night I was trying to tell you about the South Park that I had seen, and I couldn't remember the terms they were using, and I finally found them online. The presidency is between two people. The giant douche... and turd sandwich. Hillary is turd sandwich. And of course they had the principal of South Park High School running for president with orange skin. And he of course is giant douche. And what they were kind of saying was they were saying like, who are you for, the turd sandwich or the giant douche?
Didn't they do this like two seasons ago, three seasons ago?
Did they really?
Yeah, I think I recall them. We had to decide between the big turd and the deuce sandwich or something like that.
Yeah.
Two, three seasons ago, there was no election.
Well, maybe it was four seasons ago.
But anyway, what they did was, I mean, they really, what they pointed out more than anything else is how really... we don't have anybody to vote for that we feel enthusiastic about, you know.
I don't get it because, you know, you'll admit Hillary Clinton is extremely qualified, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, but this election just pointed out, I think, because of the people who are running, that she's a politician and we're sick of politicians. But she is still extremely qualified.
No, she's extremely qualified. And, you know, if I said that anybody was qualified to be president, it was her. To even indicate that
Trump doesn't have the qualification. Hillary does. Has so
not even close.
The giant douche has the qualifications. It's ridiculous. even Phil has to admit that he hasn't had any experience in that.
No, he hasn't. But
We're not going to get into an argument tonight about.
I just saw Steve Forbes today.
Good for you.
You know, and I will say, I will never donate another penny to the Fraternal Order of Police.
Why is that?
Because they endorsed Trump today. As much crap as the police have been going through with, and I am on the police's side the majority of the time with their, supposedly targeting black people and stuff. But as bad as Trump has been, with being racist, and I'm sorry, Phil, he has been racist.
Will you let Jason finish?
Go ahead.
Are you through?
Let me tell you something about the Fraternal Order of Police. When you get called by those guys, it's really just a phone room with six or seven alcoholics that are sitting around that have a contract where they collect and they give 50% of the money to the police organization that they say they're collecting for, and the other 50% of the money goes to them. How do I know? Because
you did
when I first became a reserve, the officer that I was training with had a warehouse, and he rented the warehouse to these guys and they set up a phone bank there, and he told me what the situation was. Whenever those guys call me, I know it's a scam. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now Jeff obviously, can you see us, Jeff?
Yeah,
we can't see you though, so I can't see when you raise your hand. So when you want to say something, just blurt it out.
Just try this.
Be like Phil, blurt it out.
Yeah. It sounds kind of shady though. Warehouse, what's going on?
Don't worry about it, Jeff. But is there anything you want to jump in with here?
Well, what I'd like to say is that at home I often get a lot of calls from us. "Quote unquote police or firemen," I always ask them. I said, "Are you a commission? Are you getting a commission from this job?" And they said, "Yes." And I said, "No, thank you. Goodbye."
50% of the money. A police officer will never call you and ask you for money. A fireman might stand out there with his boot at a traffic light.
I'll never give them money because they shouldn't be in the freaking street panhandling.
Well, what they do is, they may be collecting for kids' gifts at Christmas and things like that.
Oh, no.
Get out of the road.
Kids' gifts at Christmas. I can take care of that in a way where I know it's going to a kid.
Well, believe me.
Jason, I just have a question. Are you saying that you don't want to give them money because the government should be giving them money?
No, in that case, it's because they're in the street.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't like them in the street. You shouldn't be.
I don't like the panhandling really like that by them.
Well, they got the truck there. They got the uniforms on, and then they got one of the rubber boots, and they run around.
Their causes are good, but they should not be in the street.
I don't get the rubber boot deal. What's the deal with the rubber boots?
Put the money in the boot.
Oh, yeah. You put the money in the boot? No, I guess it's because I haven't had a car in the last
If you're standing in front of a store years. Or something like that, I'd be more than willing to throw a couple of bucks in. But when you're in traffic, Salvation Army, if you're in traffic, I hate that. When they're at a stop sign or a stoplight, I've seen them get hit.
Well, they're taking the chance, but that's their cause.
The collection that bothered me the most?
Yeah,
is when you used to go into movie theaters and they would take a collection because you're stuck in that fucking movie theater, and now they pass in this bucket, and if you don't put money in, people stare at you.
Oh, what about when you check out at the food? You check out at the food store, and the checker says, "Do you want to donate a dollar for cancer research or something?"
I don't mind that. No, either you say yes or you say no. They don't really give a rat's ass.
No. But I just wanted you to know that those guys who are calling and saying that the benevolent police department or whatever,
they're Fraternal Order of
Police. We're making a big mistake. We have a perfect opportunity here.
What's that?
And I hope you won't take this the wrong way, Patrick, but we could have Patrick be the
hood ornament.
Not a hood ornament, but the poster child for some charity we want to come up with.
Well, what about the Gavin
chair?
He's in a wheelchair.
We got a beginning right there, I hope you're not upset at me saying this, Patrick, but we could really make some bucks here.
As long as I get a good cut on
the absolutely. I mean, you're
Jerry Lewis is looking for a cause.
His cause is trying to stay alive.
You know,
to avoid room temperature, you know. But yes, Jason.
Just a real quick side note. I wanted to ask Phil because I'm wanted to be curious how involved he is. Do you know any contests where I could win a pair of shoes?
No.
What? It's your company, your Facebook thing.
It is?
So, yeah, I was just curious if you were involved with that at all, and well, obviously not.
No, what's this?
I have no idea.
Is this an ad that showed up in his name on Facebook?
I've liked the Carpet One thing, and it's something about take a picture of your feet, and you could win a pair of shoes.
You know, I haven't seen
a different flooring.
I just got something shipped to me, some materials, and I told the girl to handle it. But
I was just curious how involved you were, since aren't you the CEO of the
well, listen, I'll tell you, I'm just getting so sick of it now. It is getting out of hand. Are these robocalls?
Yeah,
you know the people calling you and telling you, oh hey, you know, we have a
refinance your student loans.
Yeah, you know what I've been getting is at work. It's like three times a day I get robocalls telling me that our Google Maps subscription has expired and that we need to update it and all this kind of stuff. It's like three times a day.
Oh, yeah, from three different
phone call people.
I got one. Yeah. I got one the other day that I really loved. It said, you know, your car insurance is running out and you better re-up it very soon and we'll do it for you. And I'm thinking to myself, I haven't had a car in 13 years.
Okay. Mine's a car warranty thing, and I got something in the mail. It was to file a class action lawsuit against them. And that was, I get them all the time about filing a class action lawsuit. And I actually did fill that one out because I am on the do not call
list. And there are people, I mentioned this the other night, there are people who do get calls regarding their tax bill.
And this
they actually say this is the IRS. And it's not the IRS. Why doesn't the real IRS go after these people?
Yeah, I got these on my cell phone. You know, the IRS is going to sue you, is going to file a suit against you unless you call us back away.
But why is our so-called government that's supposed to protect us from such things not going after these people? If anybody deserves to get arrested, it's somebody who identifies themselves as the IRS. And even if they say...
Up in our country.
Huh?
They're not in the United States. They're scamming from somewhere.
Yeah. But, I mean, I just, you know, I'm... And then they say, if you want to be placed on our do not call list, please press 9. So I'll press 9, and I'm thinking to myself, does this really work, or is this that they know I'm here now?
Yep.
You know?
Yep. You know, I think I was watching something about people in India. It's not illegal for them when they're working for, say, GE, and they're calling you on some legit thing, and they're getting your information. It is not illegal for them to write down your information. And then they can turn around when they get out of work and sell it to somebody else or use it for some other nefarious reason.
Oh, boy.
That's because they're a higher caste than us.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm gonna have to tune out because I'm getting a little tired.
What, you just came on?
I know, I don't want you to get mad, but the dog is crying. I'm gonna have to take her out. Hey,
don't give him shit. He's saying goodbye.
Night, and he's been protesting.
Just get on your phone, call us, and we'll let your dog take a dump on the air.
It's not safe to.
Okay, I'll just go. Nice. All right, I'll be right back.
You'll be right back. Okay.
Yeah, I'll just mute my microphone so you don't hear the calls.
So you can go what?
I'm going to mute the microphone so you don't hear the cars going by.
Oh, okay. And then you're going to take the dog
out. I'm going to come back. Yeah, I'm going to go out in the backyard.
Okay. He's going to take his dog out for shit. So if you see on TV an empty chair there, it's just Tony is usually an empty chair there anyway when he's in it. Anyway, where are we? Oh, yes. What else? What's happening in the news today? Hillary's not.
Hey, so I text Phil about this, and I was just kind of curious on different people's opinion. I was really curious on his about the pipeline going through the Dakota Pass. the Dakota Access with the Native American, reserve where they're trying to put the oil pipeline through their territory. Uh-huh. You know, isn't that kind
of jobs? But I don't know. Then other people say it's not going to bring any jobs. Then they said it's going to bring oil. And then they said, no, that oil is going to go somewhere else. So, you know, there's two sides to every story, and I don't know which one's
right. But still, Phil, my whole point is, okay, do you agree that Europeans came over here and overtook somebody else's land?
Too late.
Okay, too late. Okay, so, we put reserves up and said, this is your land now.
Yeah, correct? No,
So we should just say, fuck you again?
But the United States government has already said that you guys are a sovereign nation and that you guys get to decide what goes on in your land. I mean, the United States government has already said this.
And so we should just be able to go in.
Isn't the pipeline elevated?
Doesn't matter if it's elevated or buried. If there's a water reserve underneath that, or it's your land and you're a sovereign nation, does the United States have the authority to be able to come in? Your whole trilateral commission
Patrick might have an answer here. Yes, Patrick.
Trilateral, my ass. anyway, remember, this happened very similarly when Ulysses S. Grant was president. He had made peace with the Native Americans. And then all of a sudden, gold was discovered in the Black Hills. And he had to go back on his own word. And he sent General Sherman to basically annihilate the buffalo so that the Native Americans would leave that land. So it's been done before. Now, here's the thing. I don't agree with anything happening on that land because... Again, like you've said, it's been given to them. They're now a sovereign nation. That's the land that they've been promised. Mm-hmm. Leave it alone. I mean, we already fucked them once, and there's no sense in going back again. And if it's not, like Phil said, if there's no definitive answer that it would be beneficial to the nations, and I don't mean United States, but to the Native American nation that it's going to run through. Mm-hmm. It's not for us to, I mean, I don't think it's up to the government to do it then. I think it's, I know a number of the nations have their own commissions and government that if they decide that they want it to come through, let them vote on it. And if they decide against it, it's not. And it's the same shit as what, I forget what the term is, where the government can come
eminent
in.
Eminent domain.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same fucking thing. I don't agree with that either. If it's not going to be some kind of benefit for everybody, there's no point.
Can't you go around? You know, how big is this nation?
I mean, but the question is, if you go around, how much is that going to cost you? Is it?
It doesn't matter. Spend the extra money.
Right. How much is it going to cost a private corporation?
Damien, this is a country that has spent its entire history spending money badly. You know,
oh, I know.
You know, and we don't spend it on the right things. We can't spend money on, home care for kids, but we can spend money for, a bomb or an extra tank or whatever. And I just, we've never been moralistic that way. Yes, Patrick had his hand up there for a second. Oh, did you? Oh, you didn't? He goes, nope. Who, me?
I may have moved my hand.
Yes, Scott.
Technically, the pipeline does not go into the Indian territory, their nation. It goes nearby, but it crosses a river that's upstream from their spot, and they're worried about the oil leaking into the water and then contaminating their water resource.
And we could say from a scientific standpoint, there's nothing to worry about, but they always wind up leaking and always wind up decimating and
terrorists rivers. Terrorists could blow the thing up,
in your Trump world.
we have oil pipelines crossing in the Great Lakes from the UP to the Lower Peninsula, And that's what a lot of people in Michigan are fighting now, too, because these pipelines, they're, you know, 50 to 100 years old or whatever, and, you know, they're going to leak. You know, and this is the Great Lakes, the largest body of fresh water in the world.
Is Lake Erie close to Michigan or no?
Lake Erie does border Michigan on the very edge.
Yeah. Well, Lake Erie was the most polluted water anywhere, except maybe, you know.
And that's what gives your guys' New York pizza the water for your guys' dough to get that special flavor.
They've actually cleaned it. It's much better now, but it was very, very polluted.
Down here in New York, if you use that water, you actually do get a turd sandwich.
You know, there's been studies. They said that Manhattan water is the tastiest water of any water.
Detroit. No, Detroit water is the best water.
You just said that you're from Detroit. They've said that New York, they were bottling New York water for a while and selling it.
They wanted to do it in Detroit, but I think something came up where they wouldn't let them. Because Detroit water is supposed to actually, that was Flint, not Detroit. Close when they got rid of the Detroit water, that's when they started having the lead problems. But the Detroit water,
but
because
they got the lead out.
They went to different pipes, I thought.
They went from the Detroit system over to the Flint River, and they didn't have the corrosion protection on the pipes, and because they had old pipes, the lead started leaking into it.
Now you're where again, Jeff?
Well, usually I live in Connecticut. Right now I'm in Atlanta.
Wait a minute. Hold on a second. How did you... Well, I know how you probably got from Connecticut to Atlanta, but why are you in Atlanta?
Well, my sister lives here. Oh. And I'm at my sister's house today.
Huh?
And I'm going to be with my sister
for
the week.
How old is you? How old are you? You're like 72 or something.
I'm 70.
70, and how old is she?
And she's younger than me, so I don't know. She's like 4 years younger than me.
Oh, she's a mere child.
That's right.
Yeah. Remember when she was your kid sister?
She was.
And I bet you still call her your kid sister.
No, I don't use those words, but I know there is a certain attitude that I'm never going to give up with her.
Yeah. Because I think for years you tend to look in the mirror and still see the younger self, your younger self. And then one day you wake up and reality hits and you go, what the fuck happened to me?
Think like I'm a 20-year-old. You know, I still have the same thought patterns. And
the same childish inclination to vote for a guy like Trump. Yeah, absolutely.
I think I always see things from, not from what other people see, but what I see.
Yeah.
And in my brain, I'm still 48 years old or whatever you want to call it.
That was the excuse my dad had. My dad had a facelift, and I asked him why, and he said, because I looked in the mirror and I saw this 60-year-old guy, and I didn't feel like a 60-year-old guy, and I just wanted what I saw in the mirror to reflect what I felt like.
Yeah, well, I looked at myself naked in the mirror the other day, and I've lost all this weight, and I went, I look better when I was fat. You know, because what I've done is I've started to crepe. You know?
Just put some clothespins on your back.
That'll go away eventually. Skin's pretty elastic.
Yeah, it will go away eventually.
Wait a minute. I'm having trouble with Patrick. I was trying to get him back online, and it wouldn't go. Yeah.
I had quite a bit of problems today. And
you were having problems, too. Yeah. Some days we have Skype problems. Other times we don't. Why hasn't somebody come along and been a competitor to Skype? Let's see now if this works.
Because there we go.
Okay, Patrick. I tried to click you on before, Patrick, but it wouldn't let me for some strange reason.
Hey, all I know is I should be pretty happy. I put a bid in on something on eBay the other day and forgot about it. And then all of a sudden, I got and all I did was increase it by $2. It was one bid. I increased it by $2 and I forgot about it. Well, I won it just now.
You know what? I had that happen to me. I've never used eBay before. And then I had to get myself one of these DAP machines, and I bought a DAP machine.
What's that?
A digital something.
I see what you did there.
Yeah, I see what you did there. And it was really, it turned out it wouldn't play the long playing tapes. So So I had to go get another machine that did. So I've already spent $150. So I'm looking for the cheapest one, and there was this one that was some like around $75. Well, of course, when you get down to the last minute, people start bidding. Mm-hmm. And so I somehow got up in that thing, and I started bidding and bidding and bidding. And finally, it was over with, and I won. I have never had such a rush in my life.
I know.
I mean, it was just, I was euphoric, and I got it for like $110, which was fine. But some guy put in so much, and I went, I'm going to go another $10. Let's see if he beats it. And I hit the $10 just as the thing was almost over, and I won it. And I just sat here going, my fucking God, this is the most wonderful thing that's happened to me.
You think that's great? That's how I got my house.
Really? No, really?
Yeah.
On eBay?
Not on eBay, but it was an auction.
It was an auction, yeah.
Yeah, I gave my wife a limit. I said, you can go up, you know, to the certain amount. I said, but only go up $5,000 more. And then she did. It was like 20 minutes before it was over, and we got it.
So did you get a good price on the house?
Hell yeah, dude. I, you know, when you're talking about your girlfriend's apartment, we got our house for like $75,000 or $80,000.
Why were you bidding on it? Was it like being repossessed or something? Or
oh, the people just walked away from it. But you know, now it's now like Zillow and these other real estate places say it's like $300,000. So,
and how much did you pay for it?
$80,000.
Yo, you lucky son of a bitch.
Yeah. So, you know, when I sat there and I'm like, oh, damn, man. You know, that was pretty sweet.
My girlfriend paid like only about $125,000 for her condo, which she has about 4 years left to pay off. I mean, because she made double payments and things like that.
That's true.
And it's worth maybe 3 to 4 times what she paid for it.
Easy, yeah.
I mean, those things are happening now. But just like they're going up, they can go down too, you know.
Yeah.
But you're not, you like the place. You don't have any intention of moving. So
and that's my thing. A lot of people, when the housing market crashed, I'd ask them, be like, you know, do you still like your house? Yep. Is it still worth that to you? Yep. Well, then it's still worth it.
And don't
what
even
Steve
worry
Forbes
about.
Said was that, you know, because he was asked about Steve housing and if it was going to be a bubble and oil.
He's a moron.
Yeah. Well, no, he's not. He's a very smart guy.
No, he's a moron.
And he's a nice guy.
He's a moron.
Well, anyway, you know, he said it's all tied to the dollar and gold. You know, gold is pretty much fixed, and because the dollar fluctuates, that's what causes the things that, you know, to go up and down. So that's why sometimes there's adjustments in the housing market, but eventually it'll come back.
Well,
he said,
you know, my business manager, who is just as smart as Steve Forbes, said, you know, it's going to go down again. And he says, just as sure as it goes down, it's going to go back up again.
Back up, right.
You know.
Steve Forbes said that, like, with the stock market, he says people get very emotional. He said you should never put your retirement money in the stock market. You should put it in, like, a fund.
Well, I say prostitutes, but that's just my theory.
Yeah, and he said, look, you know, when the stock market in 2009 was at its it turned around, but before that, it went down, and then if people sold, they didn't put it back in at 2009 to ride it up.
We would have gone to one of these lectures if we wanted to hear it.
If you lived in San Francisco, you would have been able to, but I probably
wouldn't have gone anyway to hear that moron. Anyway, yes, Patrick.
Speaking of retirement, I got some great news for me.
I
lost another client.
Oh, boy.
Well, how's that good news?
Did Renee fire you?
It's not. No, they're merging with another credit union.
Really?
Yeah, so then they've got their own marketing staff on a larger one, and they have no use for me, so.
Maybe they'll
well,
hire
listen,
you.
I have an opening here at GabNet for a graphic artist.
Yeah,
but we pay in GabNet bucks.
Let them
I hear it's almost as good as Bitcoin. Anyway, hey, listen, I got to go here. There's the theme. Boy, it's been a good show tonight. We had a nice size citizen panel tonight. Damien, thank you. Phil, thank you. Scott, thank you. By the way, how is your dog's dump?
She's pee-pee, actually.
Pee-pee?
Yeah.
Pee-pee?
Yeah, a little bit.
You still say pee-pee?
Yeah, she's only two.
Thank you, Jeff. Always wonderful to see you here, Jeff. Thank you. And Patrick, you know how I feel about you. If I were a woman, I'd be all over you. I don't know why I said that. Thanks, everybody. Give yourself a big round of applause. Let's hear you all applaud here.
From KITS, give yourself a big round of applause.
Anyway, that's it, everybody. I'm Alex Bennett. For now, but we'll be back again on Tuesday with more of the shame. In the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her, okay? And let me come back to the TV people a second and just say goodbye. And we'll, you know, we're doing the TV thing again next Friday. We do it every Friday. And thank you for watching. And now I will sign this whole thing off. Okay? Okay.